The next 20 minutes, I would like to talk about the deep ocean dynamics. And this will cover a broad range of areas, basically. We'll talk about environmental conditions in the deep sea, what you already heard a bit also from Rina, about the heterogeneity in the deep sea, variability in time, but also a bit about disturbance in the deep sea. So how often get ecosystem disturbed by, for example, volcanic eruptions or and also related to that, how resilient are communities to this disturbance? So can communities recover after disturbance and how fast? Good. So to start with, it's what you already heard from Marina. So the deep sea is the largest biome on Earth. And when you look at this graph here, all the areas that are here in blue are deeper than 3,000 meters. So it's really enormous how deep the ocean is. And I really would like to stress that out again. So I originally come from a landlocked country, from Austria in Europe. So I grew up in the mountains and have not seen the sea for quite some time. And when I was starting to get interested in the sea, in the deep sea, and also if you would ask people on the streets, I think the perception of like many people is that when you ask them how deep is the sea, they would probably reply 20 meters or probably 100 meters. 100 meters is already deep. So I think it's really important to recognize that the deep sea is like really, really deep. So when we talk about the deep sea, we consider that 50% is deeper than 3,000 meters. So it's incredible, I think. And this slide just summarizes the environmental conditions that we are having in the deep sea. And so below 200 meters, we have no light or no light that can be used for photosynthesis. And associated to that, we also have little biomass and food available in the deep sea. And also it's important to know is that the temperature is low, but also very, very stable. So when you think about the ocean that you that you know from when going to the beach, you recognize that the temperature will change during the year and also with depth, also according to where you live, of course, on our planet. So for example, when you live more towards the poles, towards Arctic, Antarctica, when you have seasons, temperatures in the winter would be sometimes below 0 degrees, the sea would be frozen. And in summer, the same place, it would be 30-40 degrees Celsius. And in the deep sea, life is adapted to cold and very, very stable conditions. So to really like put it very, just give an overview. So the environmental conditions on average in deep sea, we have a lack of light, we have low temperature, it's very stable, and we have little food. However, there is heterogeneity in the deep sea. And when you look at this slide, you don't have to look into the details, but it should give you an impression, the colors give an impression of how variable these conditions can be. For example, here, when you look at the temperatures, you would see that here in the West Pacific, temperatures in the deep sea would be about 2-3 degrees Celsius. But there are areas like, for example, in the Antarctic where it's colder, or there are also areas like the Mediterranean Sea where it's much warmer. So all for an average, the temperature is about 2-3 degrees Celsius. We do see variations around the globe. And this is also true for other environmental parameters like oxygen, for example, pH or POC, particulate organic carbon flux. And so basically food. And why do we have this also large heterogeneity? Just to give you one example. So here you can see the temperature in the deep sea again and the deep sea currents. So the ocean is connected through currents. And one of these currents are the deep currents here that come from Antarctica and also pass by here in the West Pacific. And they cause also a change in temperature in the deep sea in these areas. And I think the one very important concept of the sea is that everything is connected. And this should be illustrated by this slide here. So the water, the currents connect different areas. There are no borders in the deep sea. So for example, a whale would migrate from in different depths in different areas. Also, the deep sea is connected, as already pointed out, Marina, with the surface water. So all the food, or most of the food, is produced in the surface waters by photosynthesis. And marine snow would fall down and would serve as food for the animals that live, for example, on the ground. And what is also very important when you want to understand the deep sea, that the generations are connected through the ocean, through the currents of the ocean. So why is that? So many of the animals in the sea, like for example corals, or here you can see some tube worms, they disperse via larvae. So when we compare, for example, this to ourselves, so we as humans, the females would get the babies, would give birth to them, and during the entire pregnancy, the baby would be protected by the mother, and is also born where the mother is. And this is different for most, many animals in the deep sea. So for example, corals would release egg and sperm in the water column, or other animals would release larvae. And these larvae, so these babies, they would travel sometimes hundreds of kilometers before they would settle down again and grow up there. So when we want to understand how connected the ocean are and how connected are also populations of species, we really need to consider, for example, also the ocean currents, temperatures in the ocean, and so on. So the ocean is connected. We have heard about the most important characteristics. It's dark, it's cold, little amount of food. But how heterogeneous is it, and how do we know that? So here just show some images from Tonga and some photos I took in Samoa, for example, and the new island that was born recently near Tonga. So when we look on land, we take, for example, satellite images, or we take photographs, and we know then what landscape we have based on these photographic observations. However, when we go to the deep sea, we cannot take pictures from the surface from the deep. This is not working because, of course, all the water is in between. So we need different technologies for that. And one of the technologies to get to know the depth of the ocean is to use a sonar. So basically, a sound wave is sent to the ocean floor, and it is measured how long it takes until the sound wave comes back to the ship again. And from that, we can calculate how deep the ocean is. And based on that, we can make, for example, maps where we see the topography. So how deep the ocean is. And if we have, for example, here seamounts, or these plains like here, or mid-ocean ridges. And so what is the scale of knowledge right now? So just recently, the Nippon Foundation and the GEPCO project was in the news, and they said that currently about 1/5 of the Earth's ocean floor is now mapped. When we talk about mapped, it's really important also to recognize here that we then know the topography, but we don't necessarily know what is like living there, as we cannot take pictures like on land. And also when you look at this map here, you see there's a big difference considering if we look, for example, here, what is like known from the coastal areas, like here from Australia, yeah, Japan, or Europe, and what is known from the open ocean, like here in the West Pacific, in the Atlantic, or it doesn't matter where we look. Generally, the further we get away from land, the less we know. And how do we know a bit more what is like living in the ocean and what environments do we find? So there are different technologies that we can use. There are, for example, floats, Argo floats, like these instruments here, which could measure, for example, temperature also in different depths of the ocean or salinity. But there are also, for example, automatic underwater vehicles, AUVs, that could make pictures. When you want to get to know more detail about the environment, so what animals live there, for example, or when we want to take samples from the deep sea and want to look at the animals in our labs, we need to be able to collect them. And for this, we need, for example, submersibles like here, or remotely operated vehicles, ROVs like here. And associated with that is a lot of technology, of course, because it's technically challenging to work at the several thousand meters depth because also the pressure is very high. And it needs a lot of technology and manpower to run such expeditions. And here you could see, for example, the robot Jason. And here next to it, you can see a picture that took inside a container where all the different screens show basically what the ROV is currently filming on the deep sea floor. So I think it's really amazing technology also that is that can be used for ocean exploration nowadays. And so by that, we know very well that the deep sea is very heterogeneous and there are very different benthic ecosystems. And I just to show here some pictures, like for example, from hydrothermal vents or from seamounts with corals or from abyssal plains with polymetallic nodules. And today, I would like to pick out two environments to talk a bit more about stability of these ecosystems and variability. And these are the deep sea abyssal plains and the hydrothermal vents. So when we look at this graph here, you can see the distribution of, for example, seamounts and which have cobalt-rich crusts here in yellow. You can see here in blue the deep sea abyssal plains with polymetallic nodules, and in orange the hydrothermal vents with polymetallic sulfates. So you see that the West Pacific is very rich in these environments that are very fascinating when we look at the biology, but that are also interesting because they are rich in minerals. And tomorrow, I think there will be a talk also by Diva talking about mining impacts. So it's I thought it would be good to know also about to set the basis for these ecosystems. Good. So here in this picture, you can see an abyssal plain with polymetallic nodules. So what are these nodules? These nodules, these black little potato-sized rocks, mineral aggregations that form over millions of years. So when you sample a nodule, you have a mineral in your hand that needed millions of years to become that big. And how does it work? So it starts with a little shark tooth, for example, or another hard substrate, and over millions of years, minerals would participate on this piece and would grow. And the deep sea floor in several areas is full with these polymetallic nodules. And it depends on which area you are on the globe, how the mineral composition is like. So at the first glance, you might think, yeah, that looks nice, but probably rather boring compared, for example, to a coral reef, where you see these beautiful corals. But when you look a little bit more into detail, you will see that a lot of that animals, like for example here the anemones, or corals here, or sponges are found attached to these nodules. And these animals, they can only live on this hard substrate. They cannot live on the sediments because they need to stick to basically a rock. And the diversity of these animals is really high. So we find many, many species on this deep sea of the plains. In addition to that, when we look at on the seafloor, and imagine you take a handful of mud, of sand from this area, from any deep sea area, deep sea abyssal plain in the world, and when you look with a microscope to all the small animals, it's amazing how many different species you find. So in a handful of sand, you would find hundreds of different species. And most of the animals that you find in there would be new to science, so we don't know what they are. And I always say I'm really like happy when I see something that I know, because usually we see animals that we have not seen before. So what happens to this environment, to deep surface plains, when it gets disturbed? So remember, the nodules need millions of years to form. Remember also what Verena already pointed out, these animals are adapted to a life in the cold with little amount of food. Everything is really, really slow. On this picture, you see a dredge track that was taken, when the picture was taken, 26 years after the track was taken. So it looks like the picture would have taken right after the disturbance, right after a dredge has like removed the nodules. But actually, this is how it looks like 26 years afterwards. And when we look then at the commune, at the animals that live in there, we would still find fewer animals than before, different species, and also less species, even after such a long time. And the animals that would only be able to live on the nodules, of course, they will not be in the sample in this place because they have nothing to attach to. And a recent study has found out that even the bacterial communities, the microbial communities, have not recovered after disturbance, 30 years after the disturbance was made. So we're talking about an environment that is very, very stable and that may be very sensitive to any disturbance. And now we'll make a switch and look to a very contrasting environment in the deep sea. It also shows again the heterogeneity of the deep sea. We look at deep sea height of malvents, which are also found in deep sea, also in your waters, as Severina also already pointed out. And at height of malvents, we have completely different environmental conditions. So we have hot water that is coming out of the so-called black smokers that are venting out of the deep sea floor. So how is this happening and why is this happening? So you all know that the water, seawater in the deep sea has about 2 or 3 degrees Celsius. And this water is sinking through the Earth's crust. It will be heated up by the magma chamber.
Bill.
And by this process, it's also enriched with minerals. And the vent fluid is then pushed upwards again through channels and is basically put back into the ocean. And while doing that, the minerals in the fluid participate and form these black smokers, or also form mineral-rich grounds in the surrounding. And I will show you now a video of a black smoker from the Lao Basin. So here, for example, Tonga. And here you would see height of mal vent sites, like, for example, Kilauea, Tokem, Ape, or Tuimalila. So this video was taken by an ROV at around 2,000 meters depth. You can see here some lasers. This would indicate that this size of 20 centimeters. And you see how dynamic this vent fluid is. This water is 400 degrees Celsius hot. It's rich in minerals. It's toxic, it is low pH, rich in sulfide. And this environment is very dynamic. So here it would be 300 degrees Celsius hot. Here it would be 2 degrees Celsius. So it's a really dynamic environment.
Sabine, we need to be very cognizant of the time. And
okay, I'm almost good. Thank you. So when we look now at the communities that live at this height of Malvents, what we know also is that when we look at these vent fields, every vent field is unique. So we find different species there and different distributions. And here's just an some examples of vent fields that are found near Tonga. And here I would like to share a video from the vent field Ape. There you could see completely different than what you've seen from the pictures from the Abyssal Plains. Very dense communities, anemones, crabs, you can see here some snails. And these communities also pile up. So when you would dig into these communities can be like pile up to 1/2 meter or 1 meter. And you also see that everything is like covered here, is whitish, and this would be bacteria that take the energy of the vent fluids and provide food for these communities. So these are the active vents, they're very dynamic. But in addition to that, when the vent fluid stops, these structures remain, and this we call inactive vents or extinct vents. And here, basically, we know very, very little about it. So I also cannot really tell a lot because this is really an area where we know very little about the communities, for example. And when we now think and compare this environment, considering how often it's disturbed naturally, it depends a lot on the region where we look. For example, in the East Pacific, there will be frequent volcanic eruptions that destroy height of Malvents. In the Atlantic, the height of Malvents are extremely stable. They probably exist like for thousands of years. And also recent studies have shown that communities at the Lau Basin vents are considered as stable. But it's really like a lack of knowledge that we have there for the extinct and inactive vents. So, with this, I would like to finish and would like to thank you for your attention.